Finally tonight, the power and appeal of virtual reality and what it could mean for storytelling. It's long been discussed in video games and other media. Now its moment appears to be arriving in the world of film. It's getting a lot of buzz at one of the country's major film festivals this week. Here's Jeffrey Brown.
I am flying through San Francisco.
Yes, it's true. I'm a bird soaring among the buildings of the city by the bay.
I crashed.
Well, I sure felt like I was flying, but I'm actually stretched out somewhat awkwardly on a contraption called Birdly. And I'm in Park City, Utah at the Sundance Film Festival, where one of the main attractions this year is an exhibition called New Frontier, showcasing a new world filmmakers are now exploring, virtual reality. Shari Freelo served as curator.
In terms of what is coming out of the storytelling community, we're really starting to see the first steps, the first baby steps of what is to come. But I do think it's going to grow very big.
One of the leaders is Chris Milk, who's made a name for himself as a director of music videos that push the envelope of technological effects. Here's how he describes the virtual reality, or VR, difference.
We always are watching the visual stories, the moving picture stories that we watch through these frames. It's always a frame, it's always a rectangle, whether it be your television set or your computer screen
right.
or
it's a
movie
screen of some kind, right?
Yeah, but it's always a window that you're looking through.
VR technology, Milk says, bursts through that window and takes you along.
It's tricking your brain into believing what you're seeing is truth. So even
tricking
though,
my brain.
Tricking your brain.
Yeah.
So it's essentially hacking your audio and visual system.
Now, I'm not sure I want my brain hacked, frankly, but I did strap on the headset and entered first Milk's fantasy film, Evolution of Verse, and then his nonfiction film, Clouds Over Sidra, which took me inside a Syrian refugee camp in Jordan.
We walked for days crossing the desert into Jordan.
It's hard to convey on your screen, but the sensation is one of being in the camp, as a young girl talks about life there.
My name is Sidra. I am 12 years old.
It was shot with a 3D, 360-degree camera system, using 8 different cameras. The Middle East, in fact, was the focus of several projects here.
For most Americans, the story in Syria is so far away, they don't really understand what's happened to the millions of people. I think that you're able to understand the impact, you know, for people just going about their daily business when a bomb hits.
Somebody walks right past me.
And that's what happens in Project Syria, created by filmmaker Nani De La Pena, who approaches virtual reality as a journalistic tool. Here I walk down a street in Aleppo. This is animation made from video of an actual street when a bomb suddenly exploded.
Whoa. Explosion goes off. Smoke's everywhere. People are yelling.
An actual event experienced virtually.
And now I'm in a refugee camp.
That's correct.
De La Pena, a former print and TV journalist, thinks the visceral impact of VR could bring new audiences to the news.
Younger audiences are growing up now very comfortable with digital environments, with having avatars, and they may not be reading the newspaper or watching television. And I think that these are environments that are really important to think about how do we do news stories and nonfiction and documentary.
Now, there's reason for skepticism here. Much of this can feel like you're merely playing a high-level video game.
How does that feel?
But the technology is improving for VR creators and opening up to the public. There was much talk here about the potential impact of Facebook's purchase of Oculus Rift, makers of one system of headgear and software, for $2 billion. It's also getting cheaper for consumers. Google Cardboard uses your smartphone as the video player and sells for just $20. The real question, it seems, isn't so much technology as storytelling. For now, VR is good at immersion, putting you into situations, into a horror film, as in Keiju Fury.
We do not fear you!
In 1979 Revolution Game, you take part in a street demonstration during the Iranian Revolution. But more intriguing and more difficult is how to use VR to tell complex stories.
So you will have to sit down?
Another top innovator, Felix Lajeunesse, explains.
I originally come from a background of a traditional filmmaking, and I migrated towards virtual reality. So it's a fundamentally different medium in the fact that, first of all, the viewer is there. The viewer is no longer an abstraction, but he is part of the experience. So you need to think of how you will articulate your story or the moment that you create, considering the fact that there is a subjectivity at the heart of it. There is someone there. So what do you see right now?
That someone is you, or in this case, me. The traditional filmmaker directs the viewer's eye through shots picked, edits made, and so on. But what happens when you control the movement? How can a story be told? And who's telling it?
Oh my God.
Lajeunesse drew from the recent film Wild to create a fully immersive environment for the viewer. Again, impossible to convey here. But I found myself sitting on a rock, looking around the woods, as Reese Witherspoon walked down the path, sat down, and looked right at me. She's looking at me, and I wanted to talk to her.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, eventually, will I get to talk to her in a virtual reality film?
You will have to give us maybe 10 years for that to be actually possible. But I think for now, it just brings you in that place where if she looks at you, it engages you emotionally in a very special way.
But you think in 10 years?
For a proper piece of storytelling that was pre-recorded to be sort of interacting with whatever you're saying, it feels complex, and you know, but probably not impossible.
Not impossible, but will we want it? Chris Milk, who's thought deeply about the evolution of storytelling, sees VR as a logical future step, one not so far removed from that very old-fashioned technology, the book.
You read a book and there is, you know, print ink on a page, and your brain reads these words and it says, these two people are standing in a field, and you imagine the two people standing in a field. Mm-hmm. And there's a suspension of disbelief that your brain goes through to put you inside of the story. Same thing with basically all other forms of media. Whereas in virtual reality, you actually have to remind yourself not to believe. You look this way, you see that way. Mm-hmm. You exist within the world. And existing within the world is a very powerful thing.
Indeed it is. It was the poet Wordsworth who wrote, "The world is too much with us." But if you want even more, look out. Virtual reality is coming right at you. I'm Jeffrey Brown at the Sundance Film Festival for the PBS NewsHour.